Welcome back, Zero K fans, to Nanolades at Dawn. I remain your host, Shadow Fury 333, and for the second match today, we're going to have Flipstip versus Hokomoko on Aquatic Divide. Bit of a risk, because Aquatic Divide tends to be a map that bogs down. These two choke points, oh boy, does it ever bog down here sometimes. But apparently this is a really well-played game, and also Flipstip is going for Jump Bot, so there's some way of over this. Actually, Jump Bot versus Gunship, so these choke points are probably not going to mean too much. Okay, let's see how this goes. So Flipstip starting out with, what are they going to start with, Puppies? Hokomoko starting out with Blast Wings, Flipstip starting out with Freakers, going for immediate construction and reclaim. Or, which one is it? Well, at any rate, immediate Blast Wing followed by Rapier, so Hokomoko hyper-aggressive right out of the gate. Flipstip, hyper-economical, and they are going for reclaim, getting a bit of extra energy and metal right off the bat. And Blast Wing, okay, burn some stuff, slow things down a bit, deal some damage. It's not too substantial, but it is still kind of annoying. If nothing else, it does force a defender. Not that that makes a difference. Like, honestly, that's actually not a big deal. A defender would be built by this time anyway. I mean, it forces Flipstip to be honest. That's the one thing. It does force Flipstip to actually make that defender rather than just going beyond a few metal extractors without building any extra defenses. Like, normally you would build a defender by now, so that's nothing special. But still, that is money that Flipstip would probably rather spend on things that aren't defenders. Like half of a Freaker. Or a third of a Pyro. No matter. I mean, at this point, it's not too different from the normal startup. And honestly, Flipstip going for a lot of reclaim. Hokomoko now building a crane. A minute and a half into the game, finally getting the first crane up. Finally getting the first worker. So Flipstip a lot more worker-focused. Which I think is probably the safer option overall. As long as you can survive with the workers. Having early workers, especially on a reclaim-heavy map like this one, that's what you want. Hokomoko, on the other hand, just now getting a crane. And, okay, there comes the reclaim. I mean, Hokomoko is at least forcing Flipstip to be remaining in their base. Like, Hokomoko is not letting Flipstip get out, or at least not getting out for free. This Pyro's kind of hooped. Second Pyro coming in to help, but really, I'm surprised no puppies are being built. I mean, for jump bots, until you get Archangels, puppies are one of the better AA options. Especially against gunships, because gunships hang around. Like, fixed-wing aircraft, puppies work relatively well against, they work all right against. But against gunships, the gunships don't move that quickly. The puppies will kill them. It's very hard to get away. But it looks like no. Immediately, we have an Archangels coming up for Flipstip. Wow. Okay, Hokomoko not really building up too much right now. What are they doing? Just reclaiming? Nope, just reclaiming. That's about it. Okay, never mind. They are building a metal extractor over to the southwest. But still, it's not that different. And this one Pyro is one shot away from dying. I don't think it's going to be hit, though. And that Archangel just about done. Hokomoko, a lot of early pressure into very strong reclaim. Into Amphib. There we go. That's Hokomoko's plant. That's Hokomoko's factory. If Hokomoko's going to build any factory, it is going to be an Amphib factory. But wow, Hokomoko's gone heavily for expansion. So that was basically just early pressure into rapid expansion. That was the strategy there. And Flipstip, I think they've called it because they're calling Hokomoko's bluff as far as I can tell. Yeah, they're advancing in. They probably figure Hokomoko was not really being aggressive. They were actually being just essentially offensively defensive. That seems to be the plan. Which is a pretty good plan. Put pressure on your opponent, they don't attack you, you can just expand like mad. Because they're just going to be too afraid to attack, but I think Flipstip knows that that's not something worth respecting. Unfortunately, I don't think Flipstip attacked quite in time. So while some damage will be dealt, these ducks will be able to defend no problem. Like, Hokomoko got enough ducks in time, these Pyros will deal a bit of damage, but will not just take this out. In fact, where's the Rapier? Oh, there's the Rapier. Alright. So at this point, the Pyros are pretty much done. They gotta move out. They gotta run away. And there's not much in the way of gunships coming up. My guess is that Hokomoko will probably push in a lot of ground, convince Flipstip that there's no more air coming in. And then afterwards, throw in a bunch of air units, because what else are you gonna do? But yeah, Hokomoko at this point, having a bit of an advantage. I think this path... Yeah, it's amphib pathable, but just barely. the ducks will probably not go through the center lake. I imagine if air comes up for Flipstip, Hokomoko will probably build a couple anglers and put them in the water. But otherwise, I doubt this lake's going to be used too much. And same with the seas over here. There's nothing... There's actually a geoplant there. If Hokomoko goes for that, that'd be pretty cool. I'd like to see Hokomoko build that geothermal plant. Good energy, pretty safe. Flipstip's probably not going to attack it, if they even think about it. I don't know how many times people even think about the geoplants over in the corners. Because unless you're playing amphib or gunships, which Hokomoko is playing both, or planes, then you can't really get it. Or hovercraft, I suppose. Hovercraft gets played in this map a fair amount. It is a flat map with some water, so hovercraft is not unheard of here. But, like I said, Hokomoko just plays amphib like everything. Okay, Sprung pointing out that this geoplant is not actually that useful. It's a ninja geothermal plant. Like, I don't see it being necessarily a bad thing. Like, maybe not be the best thing in the world, but if you're being attacked and your opponent doesn't think, oh yeah, right, geoplant's over here. I mean, how likely is the redder even to hit that? I don't know. It really depends on where they have their radar. But yes, I agree. You can't really connect that to the grid, but having that be a thing that just gives you energy that you can then use everything else for overdrive, yes. And this placeholder is doing a good job. Hokomoko doing a bit of damage to the rapier over to the southwest, but placeholder Jack over to the east, holding the line very effectively. Hokomoko still building up. At this point, I kind of expect they will start going through this lake, because what else are they going to do? The eastern front's pretty much taken. The western side, it's open. But going through that too much then communicates to Flipstip that the eastern side for Hokomoko is not defended enough. That being said, though, Hokomoko does have an economic advantage, mostly due to reclaim, but still, an economic advantage nonetheless. There's a lot more reclaim going up for Hokomoko. Flipstip focusing a bit more construction, getting a Suma on top of Razor, on top of a fusion plant. This could work okay. This could actually work out okay. Yeah, Hokomoko about to... Looks like they're about to go for the western shot. Flipstip totally aware of this. They have the radar coverage. Hokomoko, on the other hand, with no radar coverage. Wow, okay. That's kind of surprising, actually. Hokomoko only has radar coverage of their own base, so Flipstip knows what Hokomoko is up to, and not vice versa. Of course, at this point, we are getting into the defensive play of Aquatic Divide, which is why I don't like this map too much. Hey. I don't know what you could really do to fix it other than getting... these hills are probably the bigger problem. Like, if you leveled out at least this hill right here, and maybe this hill as well, you'd probably... And I guess also this internal hill, you'd probably get rid of a lot of the defensive play. I don't know if you need a path through the middle lake... That might help, but I think that would just lead to another area that gets defended up, so I don't think it would help too much. But yeah, because you can set up defenses on this side, or on these hills, it really messes things up. Like, the outside hills I can see, that's okay. Like, this hill over here and the one over here. But otherwise, no. And Sumo dealing a huge amount of damage, getting rid of all those ducks. Pissing Hokomoko off way... Well, okay, not way too much. That's actually pretty legitimate being pissed off, because that was their entire army. And Flipstip losing their commander at the same time, though. Nice ducks coming in here. I kind of wish I saw that. Sorry about that. Alright, let's get back to the game itself. Let's get back to focusing on the game at hand, although that was probably the two big pivotal moments of the game right there. Like, Flipstip losing their commander, so the eastern side is basically not being expanded to. And Hokomoko losing their entire army of ducks to Asumo, so... Hokomoko's lost their army advantage, and pretty much the entire thing that they gained from the earlier part of the game where they ended up basically convincing Hokomoko, or convincing Flipstip not to attack, Hokomoko's kind of lost that. And given the Sumo, I don't know if it's worth building up gunships, but they are! Hokomoko going for a crow! Emergency move for Hokomoko. They want to get this crow because I think at this point they figure, I need to just kill something. I need to kill everything. Like, it's not a bad move. But any other gunships are going to be just, I think, wrecked by the gravity guns here. That's the biggest problem. The Archangel's also at large, but mainly the Sumo at this point with the gravity guns is going to be an issue. And Duck, that's a dead Duck. Yeah, shattered that duck. If that duck survived, that would have been a really bad move. Okay, that's what I thought. That apparently the sumo does have gravity power enough to hold the crow. But the thing is, the crow kind of doesn't care. It more or less wants to just get on top of something and smash it. The question is whether or not it moves the crow around. Like, swings it around the same way it swings around everything else. Or pushes it away hard enough that the crow isn't able to actually deal the damage it needs to deal. At this point, this is, I think, becoming Flipstip's game very quickly. Hokomoko's crow is the only hope, and the crow is just about done. Oh, okay, no, apparently, well, we'll see how much power the Tsumo has in that crow. But sheesh, those moderators, those are going to be a problem too. And then the placeholder on top of that, this crow is going to have a really hard time degunning anything. The main laser cannons are going to have no problem, but everything else, yeah, that's going to be an issue. Actually, even the main laser cannons are going to be a problem. The Tsumo gravity guns outrange it, so yeah, good luck with that. Now's the perfect time to degun. There's the degun. Oh, there goes the placeholder too. Is that the Archangel on top of that? Oh, moderator as well. And it looks like the crow more or less flung straight into Flipstip's base. But no, it's trying to go for that sumo. That sumo is the target. Hokomoko wants it dead. And at this point, if it dies right now, Hokomoko gets a lot of reclaim to work with. Where's Hokomoko's commander, by the way? Hokomoko's commander over in the southeast side of the map. I mean, if that can be taken care of, and that sumo, 2,000 health left, it's gonna go down. There's no retreat. There's no escape. It's dead. I don't think we're gonna see a D-gun, though. No, it's just gonna die. And now we're gonna see the reclaim. Or at least we should see the reclaim. That's the idea. And another placeholder down. These archangels are basically gonna get themselves killed with the ducks. And the crows have no concern. They can go over to the eastern side of the map, and there's basically nothing to stop them. Or stop it. Not even then. There's only one crow. So the Battle of the Demi-Striders is over. Flipstip's getting their own gunship plant. They do have a single rapier. They have one. But at this point, the crow, oh, it's going to come over here. It's going to go through the base from the side here. That's going to wreck everything. And it's going to degun the base. That is going to be a massive blow. There isn't much here that Flipstip has to defend. I mean, the moderators would be nice, but the moderators are not in position. The Archangels frantically rushing back, trying to get back here. What? No, the crow, it's perfect timing. The crow can go to the main base, but no, it looks like Hokomoko does not want to risk losing the crow. I can understand that. It doesn't have a huge amount. It's at half health. So I can understand that. But still, that was a substantial amount of damage. That was a lot of damage dealt. Substantial amount of damage. That was enough damage dealt that Hokomoko, with the reclaim here, basically gets back their economic advantage. Wait, Hokomoko hasn't... Oh, I guess they haven't scouted the base. Okay, Hokomoko mentioning in chat, they have not actually scouted the base yet at this point, and that's... That's... Really? Because I see the ghosts, but okay. I've kind of learned not to trust the spectator mode ghost thing. It doesn't seem to be correct. Apparently they hadn't scouted the base, but yeah. But honestly though, with the crow's D-gun, it would have wiped out this base. Like, it would have completely crushed this, possibly winning the game outright. But it would definitely have helped. Unfortunately, these ducks moving just into the moderator range to their death. Not what you want to do. And the crow... As the crow moved in the moderator, it should not do that. It really should not do that. Oh, wait. I didn't want to... Crap. I forgot that's fixed later. Sorry. The moderator... The spectator crash there, or the... Not spectator. The info bubble crash. It's something to do with the text. It actually crashes it. That got fixed in the next update. Sorry about that. I forgot that wasn't fixed yet. I thought it had been fixed, so my mistake. But yeah. I mean, I can understand the fear of losing the crow. That's a lot of reclaim to donate to your opponent. So I'm not going to fault Hokomoko for that. That was a good safe move. Like, There's not a good reason to really have the crow follow his death. There's a good reason to repair it right now. But yeah, that probably would have been suicide. So I can totally understand that. And there's no way Hokomoko would know. And the thing is, what Hokomoko did, the damage Hokomoko did do, was still enough that it knocked Flipstip's base economy down to be on par with Hokomoko. I mean, at this point, Hokomoko is accessing. They actually need more energy right now. Or they need the wind to start. No, no, they need more energy. The wind generators are about full. So that's the thing, is honestly, Hokomoko right now... Actually, I guess that's the reason why I was saying the geoplant. Yeah, you can't connect it to the grid, but at the same time, if that geoplant, that's 35 energy. Right now, if Hokomoko had that, every bit of energy that these produce would go to overdrive. None of it would go to production. Because the production's bottlenecked by metal, and the metal is not going to get that high. So the geoplant on its own, yeah, it's not connected, but it allows everything else to provide overdrive, or provide overdrive energy. So I still think that it's worth having a bit of a ninja geoplant there. At the very least, it makes your opponent know, hey, by the way, I'm going to take that. If you don't get in my way, I'm going to take that. And now your opponent has to think about that. It's one more thing they have to worry about when they're fighting on this map. Like, that's still valuable on its own. Just keeping your opponent on their toes. Keeping your opponent from thinking, wow, that's a lot of ducks walking into fire there. I did not expect ducks to be so pyromaniacal. Especially in a masochistic way. Okay, this Firewalker... Where is Hokomoko's radar? Please tell me Hokomoko... Hokomoko does not have radar on the Firewalker! Oh, that is so painful! Oops. Wait, where's this? There we go. Oh, if they had radar on this, they'd know that there's basically no risk here. Oops. There's basically no risk attacking that Firewalker. Because it's very nearly alone. Or at least was. It's retreated now, but it was at the time very nearly alone. Hokomoko, I think, just lost that radar, though. Or, no. Is this the radar? No, I don't see radar anywhere. It looks like Hokomoko actually did not have radar on this side of the map. I mean, we saw before, Hokomoko didn't have much radar. They have radar over to the eastern side of the map. They have basically none to the western side of the map. So, it's not... It's always good to have radar sprung. It's always good to have radar. It's a much lower risk strategy as far as scouting goes. Especially on a map like this. This is a flat map. Look how flat this map is. It's so flat that you could put radar basically anywhere. And if you had some kind of full map distance radar, it would pretty much see everything. This is a not particularly radar intensive map. Like, it's a map that needs one or two radar towers and that's it. You don't need that much radar, but it's super useful. Also, why is this crew not being repaired? I realize it has out of combat regen, but come on, it needs repair. Flipstip going for more anti-air, a lot of anti-air actually. To the point that I really agree with this Dante. I mean, at this point, it looks like Hokomoko pretty much got Flipstip thinking, oh crap, I gotta worry about Crow. And hasn't even revealed the Dante yet. Does Flipstep even have radar of this? Okay, they should have radar of it. Not sure why it's not showing up, but they should have radar of it. It's in the radar range. But yeah, that Dante is going to be a major problem because there's not much to deal with it. There's the Firewalker. There's moderators over to the wrong side of the map. But not much to actually deal with the Dante itself, and a lot of anti-air being built up. What anti-grav is going to be built up now? I think it's been spotted. Strider up coming up. Okay, so at least Flipstep's responding in kind. But Hokomoko now, they've got a lot coming in here. I think Flipstep should probably know by now. Or not. No, they don't quite know. Okay, now they know. Now they know. What's their response? Their response is an ultimatum. That's a good response. I agree with that response. That's pretty good, typical anti-Strider response that you want to go for. And Eraser being built up. Nice. I like this idea. The idea being very simple. Put ducks in the eraser field. Cloak everything up. Walk into the moderators. The moderators cannot use their range advantage. Downside, though, is Firewalker's counter cloak. So the moderators still get rid of most of the ducks. Ah, that's painful. If it weren't for that Firewalker, this eraser strategy would be perfect. But unfortunately, there is a Firewalker, so it doesn't actually do that much good. And, okay, moderators do have an insta-give advantage. They can, I mean, obviously do kill immediately, but ducks fire off their rockets. They die, but they fire off their rockets. And yeah, Dante did retreat, come to think of it. But yeah, the thing is, they fire off their rockets, well... Sure, the moderators kill the ducks, but the ducks have already killed the moderators. The moderators will be killed by the rockets afterwards. But moderators are more expensive, so it's still totally worth it. Why is this duck not close? Oh, Hokomoko needs more energy. This is why I pointed these out, because that's a lot of energy that doesn't matter if it's not part of the grid. It's still energy. It's still there. Like, energy is still energy. It's still good to have. It may not be part of the grid. It may not be perfect, but it's still good to have. Blast wing attack, so that's going to be kind of painful. But at this point, we still have the cloaking. We still have... Ah, just being spotted out. Firewalker just spotting out the ducks. Should be killed now, though. These ducks are going for a suicide mission to get rid of it. Okay, are you going to kill it now? No, no, the ducks are going to die in the process. They're going to try, but they're not going to make it. Alright, so at least, I mean, got some damage in. Pushed Flipstep back a bit, but Hokomoko is still not really making much headway. At any rate, Firewalker, okay, no, you do attack a Firewalker because you force that Firewalker to retreat. So, there's nothing bad about attacking a Firewalker necessarily. The problem is just that you have to make sure that the Firewalker is... Ooh, that's painful. Just gotta make sure that the Firewalker is not too heavily defended, and if it is, well, at least you push it out of the way. That's the important thing. If you can kill it, even better. If you can get it out of the way, that's still good. Dante apparently going on a suicide mission, but there are some distractions. At least Hokomoko attacking on multiple fronts here. Eastern side getting built up while the Dante assaulting the west. The Crow's original attack haven't been rebuilt, though, and I'm starting to feel like Hokomoko may have been a bit too cautious early on. I mean, I was pointing out, yeah, given what they know, but at this point, I feel like it's biting them. I feel like their excessive caution is causing them to not take opportunities they need to take, and Flipstep is taking those opportunities. Like, Flipstep is learning more and more that they don't need to respect Hokomoko, because Hokomoko is just going to fall back. Like, as soon as any threat comes up, Hokomoko's been falling back, and I think Flipstep's starting to catch on to that. Oh, did I miss this? Nope, there's no sign of the ultimatum attack yet. The ultimatum looks like it's still looking for that Dante. Hasn't found it, though, because all parties are cloaked in this exchange. Hokomoko doesn't know where the ultimatum is. The ultimatum doesn't know where the Dante is. Oh, the Dante's ending up behind enemy lines, though. That's not great, but Scorpion on top of that. And a spider factory. Ooh, nice. Flees for decloaking purposes. Presumably. Good use of them. But yeah, Flipstep coming in on both sides. Hokomoko's one shot here right now. Oh, yeah, there's the decloak. I mean, at this point, though, the Dante still got through, but the ultimatum... How far afield was it? I don't see it anywhere. Did the ultimatum die? Oh, no, it's not dead. It's over here. But the Crow, go for the D-gun. It's going to die, but still, go for that D-gun. Ah. There were not that many razors the first time around. But hey, with the ultimatum... Oh, sorry, the ultimatum. The Dante on top of that, that's actually... That's going to be fairly effective. The ultimatum's still behind. There's the ultimatum. It's way out of the way, so the Dante still has free reign over this base. This base is dead. Not sure why the Razor's the priority target. That really shouldn't be. Scorpion's not a bad target. Gunship Plant's also a good target, but the Dante basically has free reign. Some rebuild going on in the center, though. Missile Silo being built up for Flipstep in the center, and Hokomoko's main base also pretty heavily assaulted. Hokomoko's commander is standing around waiting to die. And I believe it will be obliged. Yeah, it looks like we'll be obliged. That Jack is going to be not too... Well, actually, not too slow at getting that request done. And Hokomoko's commander dies, as it clearly wished it had. But at the same time, down goes Flipstep's base. So that Dante dealt a fair amount of damage. I mean, there's still, of course, the center area here that needs to be dealt with. And the Dante is basically dead as soon as the ultimatum gets close enough. But that being said... Nice pushback here. A lot of boys coming out. Or buoys. I don't know. A lot of boys coming out that are getting rid of this stuff. But not super quickly. Flipstep's economy, though, way behind Okamoko's. That Dante attack still did a lot of damage. How many workers are left? Okay, there's loads of workers left, though. So that's still a problem. those workers can be gotten rid of, then it's going to be over. Hokomoko will have this. At this point, Hokomoko does have triple the economy. Oh. Oh, yeah, Flipstep's energy's low. Someone pointing out that the ultimatum's not cloaked. Because Flipstep lacks energy. I mean, loads of solar plants being built up as an emergency measure, but that Dante can just run around. I mean, it should run around. It should get rid of the rest of this. Yeah, there we go. Perfect. Going towards the eastern side. Getting rid of what it can over there. This is giving a lot of room for Hokomoko to breathe. I still think Flipstep has enough pressure. They have enough that's been set up already that it's hard for Hokomoko to really rush in and deal damage. But there's still enough damage that Hokomoko can deal that can at least slow things down. And energy, once again, that will stop that ultimatum. Still low in energy, and with all these wind generators going down, that's enough. And another Firewalker down, too. This Dante is just wrecking face. And now, once again, the ultimatum, not enough energy. Flipstep burns through all their energy. Reclaiming the missile silo, too, just hurriedly trying to get the fusion reactor. I think Flipstep's going to lose this. It's really turning around. I mean, there are some attempts to get out here with the Freakers, but really, it's just... Yeah, energy is such a desperate thing for Flipstep for this ultimatum. It's not much else. So Hokomoko at this point, all they need to do, as long as... If they can get through these moderators, that's pretty much all they need to do. They can get rid of the moderators. Hell, even if they move into this lower area here, because I don't think that Hokomoko knows that Flipstep has a Dante. They might suspect, but yeah, I don't think so. And Hokomoko has 6 to 10 times the economy. This is pretty much just a matter of as long as no reclaim happens, Hokomoko wins this. But that fusion plant is possibly going to turn things around, or at the very least will allow for that ultimatum to do his damage. Of course, at this point, we do have... Oh, no, okay, so the Middle Lake is being used. We do have the Middle Lake being used. Wasn't sure if that was going to happen. Ultimately does, and those moderators... Bear in mind, Flipstep has no factories right now. Like, Flipstep only had that missile silo, which has been reclaimed. So they don't even have that. They have nothing. Oh, yeah, not to mention, boys heal very quickly in lakes. So, really, as long as they don't die, as long as they... hold their fire from time to time, they're fine. And now with all the moderators gone, these ducks can pretty much walk in unscathed. Though the fusion reactor is just about done. Where's the ultimatum? There's the ultimatum. Got to keep an eye on that. That is the next key thing. I don't want to miss every single key event in this game. But now with the fusion reactor done, Flipstep can ultimatum. And the ultimatum, is it going to come in? Yes, it will. That ultimatum will be able to tear apart the Dante. There it goes. Down goes the Dante. Dealt all the damage it needed, though. I mean, that Dante pretty much... That completely wrecked Flipstep's base and most of their economy. There's not much left to be said. If that fusion reactor goes down, that'll probably motivate Flipstep to resign. I think at that point, it'll be done. And the fusion reactor's down. Let's see what happens. I mean, Flipstep has no energy right now. And yeah, that was exactly what I thought. Fusion reactor was Flipstep's last hope. Still interesting game. Not quite as defensively focused as I hoped, but yeah. Oh, all the workers blew up too. Okay, I missed that. But yeah, just losing that fusion reactor on its own, even if the workers had survived, there was way too much pressure and way too much... Like, there was no factories. There was hardly any economy. Rebuilding would have been impossible or just about at that point. So yeah, good time to surrender. Still, kind of back and forth. Wasn't sure if Hokomoko would do it, but despite losing the eraser, that still worked out. So I still think Hokomoko was a little too safe early on, because that was very risky coming in with the eraser. I mean, it worked out. The ultimatum was out of range at the time, but if the ultimatum had gone... when everything was crossing this particular choke point, if the ultimatum had gone left instead of right, then Flipstep would have won the game. Like, it hinged on that. But if Hokomoko had attacked earlier and heavily damaged the base of the Crow, I'm pretty sure the Crow would have survived at that point. There weren't the Razors at the time. Of course, Hokomoko didn't know that, so I can still kind of respect that. But yeah, had that happened, then it would have basically been death. I'm kind of curious what... Wow, economy, we're just about even. Yeah, economy was really close throughout. Energy was in Flipstip's favor, though. Bit of excess for Hokomoko. Not bad, though. That's overall really well done. And Flipstip's unit value. Wow, so Hokomoko was basically just fighting really well with fewer units or lower cost of units overall. Bit even in the mid game, but for the most part, Flipstip was ahead on unit value. Pretty heavily ahead, too. It was more just really smart positioning on Hokomoko's part. Like, that was the thing that gave Hokomoko the game, because they did not keep their units alive well. They built more, they lost more, they didn't have as much in the way of value. They just hit where it was. They hit where it mattered. That was the important thing. But yeah, unit value is Flipstip basically was behind. Sorry, ahead. Every single part of the game. Hokomoko was behind and maybe close at some points, but basically behind throughout. And won just because, well, like I said, good positioning. Really good positioning. Especially that center lake. Getting rid of all the moderators that way, that was good. But before that, it was everything else. So yeah. Well done. That was that. Last game tonight is going to be Rar and Helwar on Kaleo. Bit of a shorter game, just to cool us off before the end of the stream. So stay tuned for that. It'll be up in just a moment.